So as we begin our service, we light the fourth candle on our Advent wreath. And let's pray. Blessed are you, Sovereign Lord, merciful and gentle. To you be praise and glory forever. Your light has shone in our darkened world through the childbearing of Blessed Mary. Grant that we who have seen your glory may daily be renewed in your image and prepared, like her, for the coming of your Son, who is the Lord and Saviour of all. Blessed be God forever. So let's pray. Almighty God, you make us glad with the yearly remembrance of the birth of your Son, Jesus our Lord. Grant that as we joyfully receive him as our Redeemer, we may with sure confidence behold him when he shall come to be our Judge, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We're going to listen to our first carol, which is A Little Town of Bethlehem. Sandra now to come and bring us our first reading.
Our reading is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 26. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Next carol is "While Shepherds Watch Their Flocks by Night." Our next reading from Luke chapter 2.
The birth of Jesus. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them at the inn.
Our next carol is "O Come All Ye Faithful."
O come.
us our final reading, which is from Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 8.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which was just as they had been told. This is the word of the Lord.
My question for the day is, what is it all about? We know the story so well. We know the characters, we know the plot, we know the timeline. But what's it about? What is the birth of Jesus about? I'm going to suggest two things this morning. First of all, God keeps his promises. And second of all, God has promised the antidote to fear. God keeps his promises, and God has promised the antidote to fear. So God keeps his promises. Well, the other week, my youngest son's birthday was celebrated, and my wife Rachel had to go away for a bit. And she said, "Chris, Alexander's grandparents are going to phone, or they're going to WhatsApp at a certain time. Please, can you remember?" And I promised. And about 2 hours after that agreed WhatsApp time, I remembered. I don't always keep my promises. I dare say you don't always keep your promises. But God keeps his promises. The angel declares to Mary at the very end of their conversation, says, "For no word from God will ever fail." What he's saying here is God says goes. What he promises, he does. Now the angel's declaration was in response to a really good question of Mary's. Mary said, "How can I have a baby? I'm not married. I don't have a family." She's not stupid. She knows that getting pregnant by herself is impossible. But the angel replies, "There's nothing that's impossible with God. God has promised it. And it will happen." This is an aside. Where did God promise? number of hundreds of years before Jesus had been born, these words were written by the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 7. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. God is with us. God keeps his promises. Now, what does God promise to do? Well, the clue is in Emmanuel, God with us. God has promised to come and, well, do what? I'm really struck as I read through the Christmas story in Luke and Matthew that the angel gives the same response to the characters that he meets, whether it's Zechariah or Joseph or Mary or the shepherds. It's the same thing to each one of them. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. When I was at, I had a gap year a number of years ago when I was in New Zealand, and I had to cross from the South Island, or North Island, across the South Island, across Cook Strait, which is one of the roughest patches of water in the world. And the wind was blowing a bit. And I remember being on the ferry, and these enormous waves, and just going up, 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 and down, down, down. And it was a bit scary. I'd say I was a bit fearful. So much of our lives dominated by fear. Just think of it, fear of nature, the fear of the power of the sea in that illustration. Fear of other human beings. What is he or she going to do to me? The fear of sickness. Well, yeah, here we are in the time of COVID. We fear of anything, can't it? Sometimes we fear of nothing. We don't even know what we're afraid of. And then we have the fear of death. I think sometimes fear is understandable, it's reasonable. There are things that are beyond our control. We have a rational fear of, well, the ship sinking. But I think so much of our fear has to do with things that are hidden in our lives. We fear being found out, don't we? We fear being found out for the, well, ultimately the shame that we have, but the stuff that we've done. Will he or she find out about we live in fear? The angel says, don't be afraid. And we're told, don't be afraid. Jesus has come to save us from our fear and shame. He's come to save us from all the chaos that we've created. He's come to wipe the slate clean. He's come to save us ultimately from our fear of death. The German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, just before the Second World War, preached a sermon that gave this sort of an illustration of that sense of being chained by fear, of being buried under the weight of our fears. And he gives this analogy of a miner who's been trapped by a rockfall. And the miner is buried, and he's waiting, and his hope is ebbing. Bonhoeffer wrote, imagine that suddenly a noise that sounds like tapping and breaking in the rock can be heard. Unexpectedly, voices cry out, where are you? Help is on the way. Then the disheartened miner picks himself up. His heart leaps. He shouts, here I am. Come on through and help me. I'll hold out until you come. Just come soon. A final desperate hammer blow to his ear. And now the rescue is near. Just one more step and he's free. Bonhoeffer concludes, that is how it is with the coming of Christ. Look up and raise your heads, for your redemption is drawing near. So what's it all about? What's nothing less than the God of the universe who created you and me drawing near in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. It's nothing less than Jesus drawing near to redeem you and me from our fears and our shame and all the stuff that we've got buried. It's nothing less than Jesus coming to free us from the shackles of the past, to give us rest and peace right now, and to give us hope for the future, whatever comes. What's it all about? The rescue draws near. Will you receive it?
So we're now going to come to God now in prayer.
This Christmas, as we sing the familiar carols, hear the familiar readings, and ponder on familiar mysteries, teach us to be reverent as we think of your goodness to us, that you have come to be our light in the darkness, our hope in despair, and our eternal Saviour. In our daily living, let us seek to do your will and help us to bring in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Strengthen your church in the name of Jesus Christ and to know the power of the Saviour. Give hope and assurance to those who bear the burden of authority in such difficult times. We give thanks for Joseph and all men and women of vision, and for those who have dedicated their lives in your service. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
God of freedom, we pray for all who are oppressed. We ask your blessing upon all who suffer through tyranny or terrorism. We remember all whose freedom has been diminished through war or violence. We pray for all who live in poverty, the hungry, and all who are homeless. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We give thanks for the Blessed Virgin Mary for welcoming Jesus into her life. We give thanks for our homes and for all who love and care for us. May we show your presence with everyone we share our lives with. We pray for homes where there is neglect or without love, where there is cruelty or deep selfishness. And we remember all who face this Christmas time alone. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for all who care for the sick and the suffering. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing upon the work of doctors and nurses, hospitals and hospices. We pray for everyone throughout the world suffering from coronavirus, and for their recovery. We remember all who are suffering in our church and in this parish. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We ask your blessing upon all who care for them. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for our loved ones departed from us, who now are in the fullness of your kingdom. Comfort all who mourn the loss of their loved ones, especially at this Christmas time. Surround them with your love, and may they always be aware of your presence. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, look down from heaven on each one of us. Come and save your people. Come and save the grapevine that you have planted. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Sum up all of our prayers as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. So as our service draws to a close, we're going to listen to one final carol. We're going to listen to Hark the Herald Angels Sing. May the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.